The next item of business is a statement by Paul McLennan on delivering the homes that Scotland needs. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Paul McLennan, up to 10 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The future of housing in Scotland affects every constituency, every community and every family in the country. In a vibrant, cohesive and forward-looking country like Scotland, all people should have a safe, secure and affordable place to live. Let me begin by acknowledging the scale of the challenges we face. I was deeply concerned by statistics on homelessness and housing in Scotland published last week. Of course, the scale of the challenge in Scotland is mirrored across the UK, where we see that the demand for affordable, accessible housing is outstripping supply. We have made significant strides, but we are still grappling with several serious challenges. First of all, on housing affordability, it's an issue fuelled first by Brexit, then by inflation and the cost of living crisis. In many parts of Scotland, house prices and private rents have risen faster than wages, pushing families like never before. Secondly, on homelessness, while we've seen progress in reducing homelessness in some areas, the root causes remain. And thirdly, housing supply and construction. We have a strong record on affordable housing delivery. Scotland continues to deliver 40% more affordable homes per head of population than in England and 70% more than in Wales. But there is no denying that house building is challenged with increased cost of supplies and high interest rates, both problems being the making of Westminster and have impacted on housing supply of all tenures. And fourthly, on quality and sustainability. As we push to meet net zero targets, we must not overlook the need for high quality places to live, nor the environmental sustainability of our housing. To tackle these challenges head on, we have significantly stepped up our response. In May, we declared a national housing emergency. In June, I set out a plan to tackle the emergency under three strategic pillars. Firstly, the need that we needed to more high quality permanent homes. Secondly, making sure we have the right homes in the right places. And thirdly, we all need everyone to have a settled home, responding to the very real challenge of homelessness. I'm pleased today to outline the steps we've taken and the further action we are bringing forward. But let me be clear. Solutions which are bold, innovative and collaborative rely on all partners to consider how they also can best support the delivery of housing for people across Scotland. I want to talk about investment. So under the first pillar for housing emergency response, this government is taking steps to unlock investment to put housing on a sustainable footing for future generations, noting that short-term decisions in Westminster can continue to hamper our ability to deliver. In April this year, I established the Housing Investment Task Force to take this work forward. The Scottish Government has committed £100 million as a basis to grow with institutional investment to at least £500 million to support the construction of around 2,800 mid-market rent homes. This approach shows that the Scottish Government is prepared to do things differently, to deliver more efficiently and create the structures that are needed to allow institutional investment to flow. And today, I'm pleased to announce a further investment of £22 million in affordable housing through our charitable bond programme. These bonds are issued to affordable housing providers, who then pay interest, which we invest directly into our affordable housing supply programme. This innovative funding mechanism enabled an additional investment of £71 million of charitable bond donations last year alone, as an example of how we can make a real difference to people's lives when we have the levers to do so, taking bold steps to offset budget cuts and build houses. But Westminster have cut financial transactions. The funding we used for this investment was cut by 62% since 2022. Let me repeat that, 62% since 2022. The First Minister raised the issue of financial transactions on two occasions with the Deputy Prime Minister when they recently met, and then wrote to her on the topic in August. So, we will continue to do everything we can within our powers to boost delivery, but tackling the housing emergency requires a joint approach between the Scottish Government, the new UK Labour Government and, of course, local authorities. I want to talk a little bit more about rural. Under the second pillar of right homes and the right places, we know that delivering increased housing supply in rural areas brings additional challenges. But between April 2016 and March 2023, this government has delivered more than 10,000 affordable homes in rural and island areas. We published a Rural and Island House and Action Plan at the end of 2023, and I have since worked with partners, including rural employers and local authorities, to step up our response. This year we will continue to fund Community Housing Trust jointly with the Nationwide Foundation, a funding package worth almost £1 million, to bring forward community-led housing projects. And as recently as 20 September, the Deputy First Minister opened the second phase of our affordable housing development at Kilbeg, Skye's first new village for a century. Now, on homelessness, voids and acquisitions. Like all members, I am deeply concerned to read statistics on the numbers of households facing homelessness. In Scotland, I do not underestimate the personal impact of every individual represented in those statistics. And that's why we're scaling our housing emergency response to deliver help where it is most needed. Now, despite homelessness pressure, in March last year, local authorities reported over 9,000 vacant social homes, most of which could be relet at some point. We are all agreed that these homes need brought back into use as a matter of priority. Local authorities can now take direct action on this after the Scottish Government allocated an additional £40 million in 24-25 as part of that overall near £600 million package. We asked COSLA for a targeted approach to reflect the criticality of taking decisive action, and this has led to 80% of these funds being allocated to five local authority areas with the most sustained temporary accommodation pressures. These are Edinburgh, Fife, Glasgow, South Lanarkshire and West Lothian. This approach will maximise the use of existing housing stock and minimise turnaround times for vacant social homes. Also under the third pillar of our emergency response, last month's programme for government committed to provide £2 million in additional support for local authorities to bring properties purchased under acquisitions funding into use as quickly as possible. We asked COSLA to target this funding at local authorities facing the most significant and sustained temporary accommodation pressures in order to accelerate the pace of change. I am pleased that COSLA have agreed and will be informing local authorities of their allocations as soon as possible. Homelessness applications in Glasgow from those who have granted refugee status or leave to remain have nearly doubled in the last year, from 1,384 to 2,709. Susan Aitken, leader of Glasgow City Council, wrote to the UK Home Secretary last week to say that Glasgow had been immeasurably enriched by having refugees in its communities. However, Glasgow has not received a single penny in funding from the Home Office to deal with the impact that its decisions are having locally on housing and homelessness services, which the Cabinet Secretary has raised directly with the Home Secretary. On the Housing Bill, underpinning our entire approach, our Housing Bill seeks to introduce new homelessness prevention duties, and then had a meeting this morning with crisis and actual practitioners talking about that. And that was an important step forward to ensure that partners act earlier and to act together and to prevent people from becoming homeless in the first place, and to ensure that local authorities can prevent homelessness where possible and respond swiftly when it does occur. We've provided over £130 million to local authorities this year, in addition to delivery of homelessness services through the block grant to support them on their statutory duties. Discretionary housing payments are also a vital tool to reduce poverty, safeguard tenancies and prevent homelessness. This year alone, we are making over £90 million available to local authorities to mitigate UK government policies such as the bedroom tax and the benefit cap, and to meet shortfalls in local housing allowance rate, which we know is one of the biggest drivers of homelessness risk. This funding could equate to more than 700 new build social rented homes or more than 1,300 acquisitions under our supply programme. In progressing our proposals for rent controls through the Housing Bill, we will ensure that rents are stabilised in the private sector, helping supporting households. To ensure we have a system of rent control that works for a thriving rented sector in Scotland, we also introduced amendments at Stage 2 of the Housing Bill that would clearly set out how rent increases will be capped in areas where rent controls apply. This will happen in a way that provides certainty for tenants and landlords, whilst also encouraging investment. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, while this Government pulls out all the stops to tackle housing emergency, we simply cannot hide the fact that this Government is hampered by a legacy of disastrous Westminster decisions. A 9% capital budget cut, the bedroom tax, the local housing allowance freeze, inflationary pressures from UK Government budgets driving mortgages up, workforce supply programmes driven by Brexit, and of course asylum backlog pressures driven by the Home Office decisions. All of this are forced on Scotland, reducing our capacity to go further. So just as the Scottish Government has recognised the housing emergency and the responsibility to act, so must the UK Government. In just 4 weeks' time, the UK Labour Government will set out its budget. Two decisions in that budget Scrapping the bedroom tax and permanently upgrading local house allowance would have an immediate and a significant impact on lifting people out of temporary accommodation and preventing homelessness. I call on the UK Government to do the right thing and end those Tory measures. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business, and I'd be grateful for members who wish to put a question where to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will know that since his appointment I've been trying to work constructively with him. But I have to say, after 8 years as an MSP serving in this Parliament, I've never seen a more out-of-touch statement delivered by a government minister. The minister states that homelessness, whilst we have seen progress in reducing homelessness in some areas, progress. After 17 years of this SNP government, we have 15,000 children who are homeless in Scotland today. Homelessness has reached its worst levels since records began, and this statement is simply complacent. The Minister has singularly failed to mention the one negative policy intervention which housing associations, home builders, investors have told him, and I know all the Cabinet as well, and that is the SNP Green Rent Controls policy, a policy which has seen the total collapse now in the construction of mid-market rent homes, of housing associations not building new homes and having to rewrite their whole investment plans, not to mention investors seeing Scotland as closed for business. The Scottish Property Federation estimates that £700 million in residential investment has been paused or lost due to the rent controls policy. And property developer Chris Stewart has said Scottish Government ministers were responsible for a loss of over £3 billion of investment, mainly in the build-to-rent sector, through the imposition of rent controls. Now, we need to see change and we need to see action. So can I ask the Minister if he will take forward two changes? Will he agree to review MPF4, which is now slowing down investment? Every house builder is saying they can't get access to land and are moving out of Scotland. Scottish home builders are building more in England now in many cases. And we also need to see the Minister accept and the Government accept that rent controls have failed Scotland and are failing renters. And will he make sure that the Housing Bill sees that addressed and, if need be, they are removed?
Minister.
Thank you. Now, can I thank the member for his question? I'll come back to my statement. I think I'd recognised it when I made the statement when I talked around about setting up the Housing Investment Task Force, the role of institutional investment. And I think that's incredibly important. That work will continue. And I think we had a chat about that when we met last week. You also were aware of the chat we had last week. There were discussions still ongoing at that particular point. But I'll come back to the point I made in the statement. To ensure we have a secure system of rent control that works for a thriving rented sector, we'll introduce amendments at stage two of the Housing Bill, which will clearly set out rent increases which were capped in areas where rent controls apply. This will happen in a way that provides certainty for tenants and landlords whilst also encouraging investment. So I take on the point that he's making. We will continue to have discussions, as I promised last week with him. I've promised and I'll continue to have discussions with investors. But also, they're also on the programme for government. We also mentioned about the MMR investment of £100 million, which will then bring forward £500 million in institutional investment. And so we have a proven record in that, and we'll continue to do so.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, President Officer. The Minister for Housing said that he was deeply concerned by the devastating statistics on homelessness. Can I just remind the Chamber, the Minister is not a social commentator. He's the Minister responsible for these devastating statistics. The Minister has presided over 40,685 homelessness applications in a year. 10,110 children in temporary accommodation. The number of children living in bed and breakfasts rising tenfold in 3 years. The worst yearly start on record for house building, with completions down 17% in a year. House building starts at the lowest since the year to the end of June 2013 in both the social and private sectors. Last week, the Minister said he accepted responsibility for the levels of homelessness in Scotland. With the shocking failure to get a grip of the housing emergency engulfing Scotland, with over 10,000 children in temporary accommodation, will the Minister take actual responsibility, stop blaming others and resign?
Minister.
I take my responsibility very seriously, but it has to come, and I mentioned there has to be a partnership approach, and I'll come on to that in a second with the Labour government, the UK Labour government, which has promised change in its role it has to play. So first of all, I want to talk about the actions that we've taken. I mentioned about the £22 million we talked about today, about the charitable donations, which then brings forward the additional funding in terms of that.
Minister, if you could just give me a moment, Minister. It would be gratefully appreciated if we could cease speaking across the aisles and let's hear the Minister.
We've also got an talking about the role of acquisitions. For example, last July we announced additional funding for acquisitions, which brought forward over 1,500 properties in all areas right across Scotland. We also talked about the additional £40 million this year, and I touched on around about the targeted approach that we've talked about in Glasgow and Edinburgh, Fife, and other local authorities. So that's £40 million this year and £40 million next year in terms of that. I talked around about the £100 million commitment in the programme for government, which would then bring forward additional £500 million. In terms of that. And I think one of the key things I talked about was working with partners. We talked about COSLA, and one of the key things, the discussions we had with COSLA, for example, was that targeted approach. When we had the discussions last year, they wanted to spread it across the other parts of Scotland. It was really important to me that we had that targeted approach in terms of that. Now, coming on to the role of where the Labour government sits, the new Labour government, which can make that difference. We talked about the 9% capital budget cut. Scotland suffered a 62% cut in its financial transactions. 62%. Yep. Labour can change that in the budget. The bedroom tax. Well, you've now got responsibility, Mr Griffin. Not the Tory party now. You now have responsibility. It's
always
up to
through
your,
the
up
chair,
to your
please.
To do that. Apologies. Chair. The local housing allowance freeze. Again, you have that responsibility in a matter of weeks to do that. And again, we talked about asylum, and you'll know the pressure's coming through from Glasgow. Glasgow's asylum pressure's increased from 1384 to 2709, nearly doubled. That's a 96% increase. So we can do, and I've highlighted the actions that we've taken, but the UK Labour government has to try and look at these issues and take your part in doing this as well. You can't defend now, you can't go back and talk about the Tories now. It's your choices, it's your decisions now, and we hope to see that difference when you've got that choice in a number of weeks' time.
I'll just remind members of the requirement to speak through the chair at all times, and I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This announcement is yet another example of the SNP Scottish Government's determination to do all it can within the powers it has to deliver for the people of Scotland. Can the Minister please elaborate on the detail of what was set out during his statement?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for a question? I mentioned about the £22 million investment, and it's been made into the charitable bond programme to increase investment in affordable homes and deliver more housing. This has enabled the Scottish Government to invest in two new bonds, providing loan funding to Link and Cairn Housing Associations to support the development of 159 new homes. Now, since 2014, the Scottish Government has invested over £482 million in 40 charitable donations, 40 charitable bonds, which have generated almost £140 million in charitable donations. This new investment will generate a further £7 million in charitable donations, which will be used in addition to an investment through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. Last year, we were able to use more than £71 million of charitable bond donations to supplement our Affordable Housing Supply Programme, which will support the delivery of more than 600 housing association social rented homes. And I'll come back to the point. The way we fund this is through our financial interactions. That budget was cut by 62%. Labour have the chance to reverse that in their budget in 3 or 4 weeks' time. Let's hope they do.
Jeremy Balfour, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware that housing building is 15% down here in Valovians. Each property built in Valovians is now costing £30,000 extra. One of the reasons this is happening is due to the inefficiency of the planning system. In Manchester, the average planning application takes 16 weeks, in Glasgow, 60 weeks. And the reason for that is because your government have stopped funding local governments properly. Will the Minister discuss this with his colleagues and refund councils properly so that there can be a number of planning officers re-employed who have lost their job?
Always through the chair, Mr Balfour, Minister.
Yes, thank you, Chair. A couple of things. One was about planning, and you'll be aware that Mr McKee is the responsibility for planning, but I'll certainly raise that issue with him. We've talked about, and he's been talking to Homes for Scotland, for example, around about the planning hub, and discussions continue on that. If he's talking about the cost of building coming forward, can I remind him of Brexit and the impact Brexit has made to that? It's everything to do with that. It's everything to do with that. If he speaks to contractors, it's everything to do with that. And can I remind him, and she still stands by this, Liz Truss's disastrous budget, which pushed interest rates up to where they are. That's been the biggest impact on house building in that regard, and we are still suffering in that regard just now. So, I have to say, Mr Balfour is a cheek bringing up these issues when his party brought forward Brexit and the Liz Truss disastrous budget.
Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Scotland's capital budget, which builds affordable homes, faces a 9% cut from the UK Labour government. So can the Minister please set out in real terms the impact and pressures this is placing on our ambitions to build affordable homes?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for her question? Scotland's capital budget, which builds affordable homes, faced a 9% cut from the UK Labour government. Can the Minister, in terms of that, now the capital cuts to the Scottish budget meant that difficult choices had to be made and contractual legal commitments prioritised. The impact on the housing budget is clear to see, and that has stymied the pace and scale at which we can deliver affordable homes. And I also mentioned previously in the previous answer around about interest rates, which are still at a high at the moment. We know from our local authority and our areas partners there is the capacity for more investment to deliver identified local strategic priorities should we receive additional capital and financial transactions, which again I will come back to, that 62% cut, which Labour can change in a number of weeks, and continue to call on the UK government to recognise this and increase our allocation.
Paul Sweeney, to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister noted the pressure that 2,709 people being granted a refugee status has put on homelessness services in Glasgow over the last year, but I also note that there are currently 2,641 long-term empty homes in Glasgow at present. Will the Government therefore introduce emergency legislation to force the compulsory sale of those unused homes and accelerate the mass compulsory purchase orders on those properties?
Minister.
As I mentioned around about the funding, obviously, which goes to Glasgow. And I'll come back to a number of points that Mr Sweeney's mentioned. Coming back to the empty homes, we've contributed £11 million, which has brought 9,000 empty homes back into circulation, which, again, has been through and includes Glasgow. We talked around about the funding, and obviously that's the funding that Glasgow gets and the additional funding in terms of dealing with homeless issues. Coming back to the acquisitions point, Glasgow's increased allocation will obviously make a difference in terms of looking at, in terms of, there's two ways we can look at this, Mr Sweeney, and through, again through the Chair. There's two ways. The flexibility through the additional funding can also now be tackled to voids. Previously it was just on acquisitions, and this now can be used to voids. So Glasgow has that ability to pick up that with the housing associations, which I know they're doing at the moment. So we've tried to be as flexible as possible in terms of that, in terms of the funding. We are doing work, again, through the empty homes, and as you'll know, empty homes and voids are quite separate. So we're doing work in terms of empty homes and through the additional funding, which does give Glasgow the ability and the flexibility to look at voids as well as acquisitions.
Willie Coffey, to be followed by Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. The Scottish Government is spending over £90 million every year mitigating the bedroom tax alongside the welfare cap, thanks to the Tories and now thanks to Labour. Can the Minister please tell us how many one-bedroom, two-bedroom or three-bedroom homes could be built for that sum of money if we didn't have to spend it protecting Scotland from Tory and now Labour policies?
Yeah. Minister.
I thank the member for his question. And I'll come on to the point. And he's obviously making the point about £90 million. This is £90 million this year. And last year, and the year before that, and the year before that, and the year before that. So, as I said, we're spending £90 million to mitigate the welfare cap. So I'm unable to break down the figures that, by house size, Mr Coffey. But on average grant investment levels, we'd expect £90 million to deliver at least 700 new-build social rented homes or more than 1,300 acquisitions. So these are not just numbers. These are 700 or 1,300 households who could be benefiting from safe, warm homes to raise their families. And as I said, that could have been 700 new homes last year, 700 new homes the year before, and 700 new homes the year before that. And again, Labour has the ability to change that when they have their budget in 3 or 4 weeks' time.
Ariane Burgess, to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement. Given that it's possible to create three homes from existing properties for the price of one new build, we certainly should be prioritising the 9,000 vacant social homes, and it's good to hear what the Scottish Government is doing in that regard. But what about the over 40,000 empty properties and vacant spaces above commercial properties, which could be homes? I'd appreciate hearing from the Minister what the Scottish Government is doing to support communities and councils to create three homes for the price of one.
Minister.
Can I thank the member for a question? I think that's a really important question, and I know we've discussed that previously in the past. I'll come on, probably looking at it from a city point of view and then into the rural communities. For example, I think in terms of cities, our cities are going through a period of change, and there's a real opportunity, I think, and looking at how we can maximise opportunities in there, and that can be done through looking at the local housing strategy and how we break that down. In rural communities, I think we've talked around about mid-steeple quota in Dumfries, and that's a prime example of how that's worked previously in the past. And again, it's working closely with local authorities in that point of view, but it's encouraging them to look at, it's encouraging local authorities to look at that as well in terms of that. The flexibility is in terms of the funding. Now, that might be through the Rural Housing Fund, for example, or just through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme that we've got, but it would be encouraging local authorities to look at opportunities around about their town centres. It's not just about housing, it's about broader economic development, and I think that's a really important part, and it's about placemaking.
Thank you. Emma Harper, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Just to pick up on the local housing allowance, can the Minister please expand on the impact of the freeze to rates of local housing allowance, the effect it has had on those private sector tenants who need support most, and how inflation, merciless budget cuts from Westminster and the looming prospect of continued austerity under Labour is affecting and will continue to affect our ambition to ensure that everyone has a warm, safe home?
Minister.
Yeah, the freeze to local housing allowance rates ended in April 2024. It means rates have now been realigned with the cheapest 30% of local rent. However, the Scottish Government and others, homelessness and anti-poverty organisations would like clarity on what will happen at the end of 24-25. The cycle of freezing and unfreezing local housing allowance rates is unhelpful to renters. It leaves low-income private renters living in uncertainty about whether they'd be able to afford to pay rent in the future, affecting their ability to plan and put down roots. We'd also like to see local housing allowance rates increase in line with at least the cheapest 30% of local private rents every year permanently.
Willie Rennie, to be followed by Edward Mountain.
17 years on, the Minister's got the temerity to come here today pretending to have a plan to match the scale of the housing emergency that his government created. He spends more time investing in excuses, blames everybody else, rather than actually finding solutions and building homes here. The housing bill has the potential to further stifle investment. So when exactly is he going to tell us what these amendments that he's talking about endlessly are actually going to be?
Minister.
First of all, I'll come back to the point. I take responsibility for that. But we have to, and it does come back to partners, Mr. Rennie and Presiding Officer. It does come back to partners as well. Local authorities have their part to play, as does the UK Government, as does other organisations like the Housing Coalition that we're working with at the moment. In mention to the amendments, we talked about that last week, and I gave you an approximate timescale in that regard. But I do take responsibility. Others need to do that also. I talked about the action, the £22 million funding that we announced today, the £80 million acquisition, the £100 million commitment to mid-market rent in terms of that, and additional funding for local authorities to tackle that specific issue. I take responsibility for that, but we do need help, partner help from partners to deliver that also.
Edward Mountain, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to remind members of my register of interest in that I provide well-maintained and tenanted housing in Moray. Given that Patrick Harvey and his misguided legislation regarding landlords forced up to 10 firms to move south of the border to build houses for let, what specifically will this government do to arrest the decline in the private rented sector, which has seen private renting housing fall from 360,000 to 300,000?
Minister.
Just a number of points, I think, just on that particular point. The reason, and a couple of things I want to pick on. One was in terms of the Housing Investment Task Force, and I think that's a real important part about how we bring institutional investment back into Scotland. So we have institutional investors themselves who are part of that specific group. I mentioned about mid-market rent and the opportunities we're looking around at that £100 million growing to £500 million. In terms of the rural aspect of that, you know, we spoke to Scottish Land and Estates, who've also submitted some thoughts and proposals into how that specific rural issue is brought up. In terms of that, I mean, I met with Mr Briggs last week to discuss about the housing bill and where rent controls are. I mentioned we were still looking at the issue at the moment, and we'll come back to him in due course. I'm happy to meet with you, Mr Mountain, or through Mr Briggs to discuss that particular point.
Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 8th of July, Chancellor Rachel Reeves said, "We need the private sector to build homes, We are not in the business of building those homes directly. The Deputy Prime Minister contradicted that to some extent 3 weeks later. Amidst the UK government's confusion, has the Minister been advised of any Barnett consequentials that would accrue to this Parliament should the UK Labour government actually take forward a coherent affordable housing strategy?
Minister.
No, not at this point, Mr Gibson. And it comes back to the point that I mentioned before then about some of the budget asks, which I think would be incredibly important for that. And I'll come back to and repeat these. One is obviously on the local housing allowance, obviously on budget cut, 9%, the financial transactions budget, of also 62% cut in that. So these are the only ones that we've raised at the moment, but I've had no update or any requests or anything from the UK Government at that stage about consequentials.
And John Mason.
Thank you. Given the limited amount of capital budget and given that we're having a housing emergency, will the Minister and his colleagues consider moving money from the roads budget, and especially the A9, to housing? Because it seems to me that housing is much more important than improving that road.
Minister.
That's an interesting comment, Mr Mason, in terms of that. I think for me that would have to be a discussion for the Cabinet to discuss that. As I said, one of the key things that I've been looking at is how do we bring additional capital into the system. And I talked about the Housing Investment Task Force, the £100 million mid-market rent proposals we're looking at, and the announcement today of the £22 million charitable bonds.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And we've heard quite a lot of blame this afternoon, but that will be cold comfort to the 17,000 wheelchair users who are in unsuitable homes and the 40,000 disabled people on social housing lists. Yet the government are relying on 25-year-old accessibility standards and they've cut the adaptation budget by 25%. Thousands of disabled people across Scotland are stuck in unsuitable homes because this government is failing to act. Mm-hmm. So can I ask the Minister, is the government still committed to a new cross-tenure design standard? And if so, when will it be delivered? And what assessment has it made of the impact of the most recent budget cut to Stage 3 adaptations funding?
Minister.
First of all, it's not blame. It's taking responsibility, but I have to share that responsibility and take ownership of that with other key partners I talked about, for example, local authorities and also the UK Government that I mentioned about that. In particular, in adaptations, one of the key things that we can try to take forward and reflect in local housing strategies is making sure that local authorities pick that up and it's included in their local housing strategies. In my visits across local parts of Scotland, there are some local authorities that are better than others in terms of that, but we can't have that postcode lottery, so we need to make sure that's part of the local housing strategies going forward. On other particular points, I can come back to the member on the points that you've raised.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement. There'll be a brief pause to allow front benches to organise for the next item of business.